so many smiling faces, and it is good to hear all the laughter and see all the smiles as we gather together. If you would, let us join together on page 231 for our opening prayer tonight, our prayer for Christmas. Let us pray. Eternal God, by the word of Jesus Christ, you gave yourself to the world. Grant that being born in our hearts, he may save us from all our sins, and restore within us the image and likeness of our Creator, to whom be everlasting praise and glory, world without end. Amen.
If I do this wrong, no laughing. Read the responsive reading on page 861, Psalm 148. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord from the heaven. Praise the Lord in the high.
Praise the Lord, all his angels. Praise the Lord, all his hosts.
Praise the Lord, sun and moon. Praise the Lord, all shining stars.
Praise the Lord, highest heavens, all waters above heavens.
Let them praise the name of the Lord, who commanded and they were created.
Who established them forever and ever, and fixed their bounds which cannot be passed.
Praise the Lord from the earth, sea, monsters, and all of this.
Fire and hail, snow and smoke, stormy winds fulfilling God's command.
Mountains and all hills, fruit trees and all cedars.
Beasts and all cattle, breeding things and flying birds.
King of the earth and all peoples, princes and all rulers of the earth.
Young men and maidens together, old men and children.
Let them praise the name of the Lord, whose name alone is exalted, whose glory is above earth and heaven.
God is raised up the Lord for his people. Praise for all his faithful ones, for the people of Israel who are near your God.
Page 246, hymn Joy to the World.
Thank you.
turn our hymnals to page 249, this song.
Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with him, with the angel, a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, "Glory to God in highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." When the angel had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord God has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told to them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, and as it had been told them. Lord, bless these your holy words, and we who hear them. Tonight, we want to sing like the angels sing. That's why we have so many songs. And we'll look at a couple of readings about some of the songs tonight. And the first one I want to look at is the hymn, "Hark How the Welkin Rings." You've all heard that hymn, right? It's a hymn written by Charles Wesley. We sing it every year. He wrote 20-some verses to this hymn. But Charles, when he was converted, he just immediately began writing hymns about everything, you know, about creation, about birth of Christ, the death of Christ, holy living. And he really wrote his songs the way he wanted them to stay forever. We ever do anything like that? We ever do something and we think it is now set in stone and it will be this way forever? Hark How the Welkin Rings. We remember that tune so well, don't we? Well, a good friend of his, a guy named George Whitfield, decided that that was just too hard to sing. And he changed the word welkin, which is the old English term for the vault of heaven, which is, you know, the throne room of God. Because that's where, hark how all the welkin rings. And, well, George Whitfield changed it to "Hark, the herald angels sing." Now, we know that one, don't we? We recognize that one so much more. But we don't always see how they change over the years. The welkin ring. Let us turn to page 240 and join with the welkin, the chorus of the heavens, and sing our next hymn, "Hark the Herald Angels Sing."
Thank you.
carry him angels from the realm of glory. Like all Moravians, John Montgomery had a burden for world evangelism. He was the only Moravian pastor in Scotland, but he and his wife felt God's call to be missionaries to the islands of Barbados. Carefully placing their six-year-old son, James, in a Moravian settlement in Barcy, near Ballymena, County Antrim, Ireland, they sailed away. James never saw them again, for they perished in Barbados. Left with nothing, James was enrolled in school in England. When he didn't do well, he was apprenticed by school authorities to a baker. Baking wasn't for James. Ran away and spent his teenage years drifting from pillar to post, writing poetry and trying his hand at one thing then another. He eventually settled down in Sheffield, England. In his early 20s, James began working for the local newspaper, the Sheffield Register. And there he found his niche. He loved writing. It was a politically active newspaper, and when it was owned, when its owner had to suddenly flee the country to avoid persecution and imprisonment, James purchased a paper and renamed it Sheffield Iris. His editorials, too, proved unpopular with local officials. On two separate occasions, he was thrown into jail, but emerged from prison a celebrity and used his newly acquired fame to promote his favorite issue. Chief among them was the gospel. Despite the loss of his parents, James Montgomery remained devoted to Christ and to the scriptures, and he championed the cause of foreign missions and of the British Bible Society. As the years passed, he became the most respected leader in Sheffield, and his writings were eagerly read by its citizens. Early on Christmas Eve in 1816, James, now 45, opened his Bible to Luke 2 and was deeply impressed by the verse 13. Pondering the story of the heralding angels, he took his pen and started writing. By the end of the day, his new Christmas poem was being read in the pages of his newspaper. It was later set to music and was first sung on Christmas Day in 1821 in a Moravian church in England. Angels from the realm of glory. His parents were very proud. They sing Angels from the Realm of Glory, page 220.
Thank you.
ourselves and our gifts to God.
Oh, night divine.
We thank you tonight, especially for the birth of your son, Jesus, for he came to the world to bring peace. And we know, Lord, the peace that you bring is the peace that makes us feel at ease. We ask, Lord, for a fresh outpouring of that peace upon us this evening, that the peace that the angels declared we will feel in our hearts. And we ask, Lord, that those who receive from these gifts this evening for our Christmas offering will receive your peace with these gifts. We thank you, Lord, that we can be about what you are doing in this world. We pray all these things in your Son, Jesus' holy name, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. You may be seated. Our last reading for tonight is once again based upon the angels. The last one that we're doing for our next hymn, which is It Came Upon a Midnight Clear, Edmund Hamilton Sears. We really recognize that name, don't we? We don't recognize a lot of the names of the writers of our hymns, do we? Well, he's actually the author of two Christmas carols that were written 15 years apart. He was born in Sandusfield, Massachusetts, in April of 1819. And he attended Union College and then Harvard Divinity School. He was ordained a Unitarian minister and chose to devote himself to small towns in Massachusetts where he had time to study, think, and write. At the age of 24, he wrote a Christmas carol that he really hoped would set the world on fire. Calm on the Listening Ear. It's another one you've heard, right? Yeah. It's amazing how we may get an idea and it takes God and time to work it around right. It was based upon the angels. Calm on the listening ear of night comes heaven's melodious strains, where wild Judea stretches far her silver mantled plains. Celestial choirs from courts above shed sacred glories there, and angels with their sparkling lyres make music on the air. That's just so familiar, isn't it? It doesn't strike a bell anywhere, does it? That does it! Well, 15 years later, to the same meter, to the same tune, it came upon a midnight clear. We recognize that a little more, don't we? But do you recognize something really unusual about this Christmas carol? There is no mention of Christ anywhere. There's no mention of his birth. There's no mention of his mission. The author's only focus is the angels' request for peace on earth. This song was written in the 1850s. So you can understand how it seemed like strife was taking over everywhere. His only focus was peace on earth. Now, this is a verse that is not included in our hymnal and is not included in most hymnals. Yet with the woes of sinning strife, the world has suffered long. Beneath the angel's strain have rolled 2,000 years of wrong. And man at war with man hears not the love song which they bring. Oh, hush the noise, ye men of strife, and hear the angels sing. Let us rise and join with the angels singing our next hymn, It Came Upon a Midnight Clear, found on page 218. and with this hymn, Away in the Manger in our closing on Silent Night, we will start the candlelight portion of our service. Silent Night.